Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the wonderful privilege that we have to come and to celebrate, to worship, and to magnify Jesus in this house. Lord, we don't come to fulfill tradition. We don't come for ritual. We don't come for religion. Lord, we come into this place to worship and to lift up the name of Jesus. And so, Father, we thank you that in this house, Lord, we exalt Jesus above all else. It's not about a man or a woman, the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, or anything like that, Lord. We acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this house. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would speak to us and guide us and lead us and direct us and motivate us through your word today as we get into it. Lord, I pray that it would be like a seed that is planted into fertile and good ground as we walk out of this place today, Lord, that we would walk out and be your church, Lord, to shine your glory and reflect your goodness for the world to see that you are God and that you love us and you love the world, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you would just bless this house, bless each and every person that's in here today. Speak to us, Holy Spirit, we ask. And Lord, we don't ask these blessings. We don't ask this upon just ourselves, but upon all the churches across the Inland Empire today that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, our denominational brothers and sisters, Lord, our various churches around the Inland Empire, churches like Harvest and Sandals and Water of Life, Ecclesia. Thank you for our Calvary chapels around the area, Lord, New Creation. Lord, we thank you for Emmanuel Baptist and Trinity. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you bless us. And Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. We thank you that you have strategically placed us here in the Inland Empire in San Bernardino to be a part of your family, to be a part of your body, to lift up and exalt the glory of Jesus Christ. So, Father, all glory goes to you. Holy Spirit, speak to us today in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. So today what we're doing is we're actually celebrating and kind of kicking off the Easter season, so we're not going through the book of Hebrews. And as we kick off the Easter season, this is a special day marked by the name Palm Sunday. Now, Palm Sunday is also synonymous with another name, Passion Sunday or Passion Week. And Palm Sunday celebrates the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem for the Passover. And we're going to look at some of those things today as we look at the message of the cross. As Jesus is coming into Jerusalem for the ultimate purpose, you and I know, and looking at hindsight later on, we see now Jesus is coming into Jerusalem with the ultimate purpose of the cross. Today I want to focus on what the message of the cross is and means to you and I, and what that is for us. And so let's think about that today. Let's look at that. And I want to ask you this question. I want you to be honest about it, and I want you to think about it. Feel the emotions. Bring them up as uncomfortable as they might be. But have you ever in your life, have you ever been at odds with somebody? Yes, we all know at some point we've all been there before, at odds. Maybe it was words that were spoken, maybe it was opinions that were different or whatever it might be, ways that were parted, relationships that crumbled or fell apart, whatever it might be. We've all kind of been there before. And you know, when you think about it, when you see that person, when you see that relationship, when you see what it was and what it is today, it's an awkward, it's uncomfortable, it's not what you want it to be. It might be that in your life, maybe somebody chose to be at odds with you. Maybe you didn't do anything or that you don't even recognize, but at some point in your life, they just said, you know what, I no longer want to associate with you, and you and I were just kind of going our own way. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. It's not a fun feeling. It's not something that we rejoice in. It's not something that we're happy about, but I think we can all relate to say that we've all been there before. Now, I want you to hold on to that thought. I want you to hold on to what it feels like to be at odds with somebody, perhaps somebody that you love. Hold on to that because we'll come back to that thought. So now we're talking about Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday being the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem 2,000 years ago and his ultimate destination, the cross, or the cross on Calvary. Now, when I was looking back at this, I thought about, you know, let's talk about lifting up. And Pastor Dan was talking about that, you know, the story as Jesus is coming in and the disciples and the pilgrims that were coming into Jerusalem at the time. They're waving the palm branches at Jesus and they're crying out, Hosanna, which means save us. And they're saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the King. And so they're glorifying Jesus, and it's this tremendous up, it's just tremendous high. And you know, Jesus, the religious, they cry out to Jesus and they say, discipline your disciples, stop them from this. And Jesus, you know the story, he says, if I was to tell them to stop, if they didn't do it, the rocks would cry out. So we could talk about praising the name of Jesus and how important it is to lift up and praise and exalt and glorify the name of Jesus. And that's such an important message for us to understand. But as I started to read the story of Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem, I looked at it and I noticed something very unique about that. I was reading through the book of John and I went through that. I looked at John and I said, man, I noticed something. And I went back to Matthew and I read the Palm Sunday account in Matthew through. And then I read Mark and then I read Luke. The interesting thing I found is I went and counted all of the chapters in the New Testament Gospels that talk about Jesus in his ministry. And then I counted the chapters that talk about Jesus from today, Palm Sunday, to Thursday, the Lord's Supper. Did you know that 30% of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, 30% of the Gospels focus on these 5 days of Jesus' ministry? Think about that for a moment. Jesus, we know, Jesus ministered somewhere around 3 years, right? That's 1,095 days of ministry, right? 156 weeks. I think I just did that in my head, so if I'm a number off, don't judge me. And yet, 30% of the Gospels account for these 5 days of Jesus' life. I think something's critical. I think something's imperative. I think something's important about this season that we call the Passion Week or the Passion Sunday, Palm Sunday, of Jesus coming in to the purpose of his existence. And today I want to talk about that. So as Jesus enters into Jerusalem, it's no coincidence of the timing that Jesus comes in. If you've got your Bibles, I want to take you with me to look at something. Look at me, look with me to the book of John in the 12th chapter. The book of John in the 12th chapter. Now, John kind of lays it out. Jesus has had just this stellar, meteoric rise in the past couple of weeks with the resurrection of Lazarus and the anointing at Bethany. And the word is just spread about this rabbi, this teacher, this healer that's going around. And the multitudes are here. And just so happens that as Jesus is coming on to Jerusalem, it's the time of Passover. Now, one thing you need to understand about Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem is, why would the people that shouted Hosanna 5 days later shout crucify him? And understand this, that Jerusalem was the epicenter of religion, so to say, at the day. People would make pilgrimages from all over the world, all the way from places like what we would know as modern day Morocco, the northern part of Africa, from Egypt, from the eastern part of Africa up, from the Arabic regions, the Middle Eastern regions. They'd come from what we would know as modern day Turkey and those areas, and they would all make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem for the Passover. The population of the city of Jerusalem within the walls was probably somewhere around the vicinity of 50,000 people. So, you know, kind of think of like Redlands, Ukaipa, somewhere in there, right? But on Passover, in the pilgrimage, the population swelled more than 10 times to roughly about 500,000 people were all converging upon Jerusalem at this very moment. So as they're entering in, all of the pilgrims who've had months of journey to get to Jerusalem for the Passover, they're coming in, and all of a sudden they see disciples and they see people following Jesus and shouting and celebrating and laying their garments on the road like a triumphant entry of a king, and they join in. The crowds and the masses join in, and the Bible says that as Jesus went, they came into Jerusalem after him. You see, they were all coming to Jerusalem for the Passover feast and the celebration of the Passover. And so here, Jesus has this incredibly high moment. I mean, wouldn't you say that that's a high moment? People are acknowledging that you are the King, acknowledging that you are the Savior, acknowledging that you are the Chosen One. I mean, what a high moment in life. And as Jesus comes in, and we know the story that they cry Hosanna and they lay their garments on the road, John the 12th chapter, verse number 27, I think really begins to reveal the humanity of Jesus and the reality that was setting in Jesus' life of what he was going to do and why he came to do it. John the 12th chapter, verse number 27, it says it like this. Jesus says that my soul is troubled, and what shall I say, he says. What shall I say? My soul is troubled. What shall I say? God, Father, save me from this hour? He says, but for this purpose, I came for this hour. You see, Jesus saying, for this purpose, for this reason, I came this hour, not literally meaning this figurative hour. Have you ever heard somebody say the hour is at hand? The hour literally means close time. Jesus says, of all of my life, this is the close time of the purpose of why I came. The existence, the reason of my existence, my coming is to be fulfilled. And Jesus says, my soul is troubled because I know what's about to go on. You see, it's not a coincidence that Jesus came to Jerusalem in Passover. It's not a coincidence that Jesus was born when he was. It's not a coincidence that Jerusalem was the epicenter of a pilgrimage at this season, at this time. This was all a part of God's divine plan, and now Jesus is enacting and Jesus is carrying out, Jesus is bringing to life and to fulfillment God's divine plan for humanity. And you and I know what God's divine plan is, and that is Jesus to die on a cross for our sin and for our shame so that we could be reunited and reconnected with God. We understand that. I love the movement that's going around right now, and it's so cool. It started a couple of years ago. But we would recognize internationally that the heart is the international symbol of love. If anybody was to flash a heart or to show the sign of love, sign of a heart, we know that that is just like that means love. And there's been this movement. You've seen it on stickers or maybe on social media or on T-shirts that the cross and then has a sign equal and then heart. See, the cross is actually the international symbol of love because Jesus talks about this, that there's no greater love than a man to lay down his life for his friends. And see, the ultimate purpose of Jesus Christ, we see, is to reveal, to manifest the love of God to humanity. Now, I asked you that question in the very beginning, and you're saying, Pastor Luke, what did that question about being at odds have anything to do with what you're talking about today? And I told you, hang on to that emotion. I want you to kind of bring it up, stir it up, get that awkwardness on the inside of you about that being at odds, because the reality is that humanity is at odds with God. Humanity is at odds with God. You see, whether we choose, whether we understand, whether we decide, whether we even recognize it or realize it, the state of humanity today is at odds with God, disconnected, disunified with God and what his purpose and his desire was. And you can see up here wondering, what is this whiteboard on the stage full of all sorts of negative things like drunkenness and jealousies and addictions and covetousness and theft and defense and idols? And see, these are all of the things that on a day-to-day basis we, humanity, live out and operate in, whether we recognize it, whether we realize it. These are the things that put us at odds with God. But you see, God had a plan. God had a purpose. God had something that he wanted to set into motion. Last week, Pastor Dan talked about the Passover feast and the Passover. And if you were here last week, it was such a vivid illustration of marking the doorposts with the blood of the lamb and marking the header of the door with the blood of the lamb. And there was the blood that was on the ground from the lamb that was sacrificed or was killed right there at the door. And so literally, as the Hebrews had to go into their house for the Passover, they had to literally pass through the blood of the lamb to be covered by God so that the angel of death would not take their firstborn. And we learned that was an image of Jesus, and that we pass through the blood of Jesus, and we understand that now. But the Passover was the beginning of the institution of the law of God. Now, through the course of the Old Testament, from Genesis to Exodus, through Leviticus and Numbers, all the way to the very end of the Bible, we see that there's about 613 different laws that were instituted with the laws of God. And the laws of God were set in motion in the Old Testament to make man acceptable in the eyes of God. But you see, when you look at what the word acceptable is, the word acceptable is to make something tolerable. Now that's a problem. Because tolerable is not what God's design and purpose was for humanity. You see, God instituted rules and regulations. He instituted covenants and laws. And he instituted things to do and things to not do so that men could be acceptable in his eyes. But when you think of acceptable in the terms of tolerable, that's like a C grade. I remember when I was in college and we'd have to write these dissertations and these papers, 20-page papers on the theories of macroeconomics and so forth and so on. I remember when I put all that effort, all those hours, you know, the night before it was due, because that's how I do it. All of that effort I would put in there, and I did not want to get a C grade. If you look at the grading scale in academia, you know what a C stands for? A C grade stands for satisfactory, which means you did the job to pass the class. Good on you. Move on. But you see, when you look above that, a B is a little bit above average. And an A grade, oh, A is an excellent grade. And then, of course, for all the Rock Bible College students, you know that there's nothing acceptable with the exception of an A plus in the Rock Bible College. And so you got to work hard for that grade. And so, you see, God didn't want humanity to come. He said, I didn't create humanity to have a C plus grade average with me. I didn't create man in my image. I didn't give them dominion over the earth. I didn't do all of this for them so that they could have a tolerable perspective in my eyes. God said, I wanted something more. But you see, we are disconnected. We are, as a humanity, as humans, at a state of sin born into us. We are at odds with God, so something needed to be done. The question is, why institute something that you would later on get rid of? Why wouldn't God just do it in the very beginning? Why wouldn't God just, when Adam and Eve sinned and when Cain killed Abel, why wouldn't God just send Jesus then? And then we wouldn't have all these problems. We wouldn't have to worry about all these different things that define who we are and that these are the actions of our day-to-day lives. Why not? Because the Bible tells us, first of all, we need to understand something about the nature and the attributes of God. And here it is. First of all, we understand this, that God never reacts. Got to get this. Hold on. Think about it. Let it settle. God never reacts. Well, Cain killed Abel, so God wrote, thou shalt not murder. God never reacts. Well, humanity, they were stealing and they were plundering and they were pillaging, so God said, thou shalt not steal. But they were having idols before, so God wrote, you shall have no other idols before me. You see, when you react to something, that means that you're no longer in control of it and that something happened outside of your control and you are reacting to it. God never reacted. The law was not a form of reaction. God acted. He knew what was happening. He knew what was going to go on. He knew the future. He had intertwined time. God is not limited to a linear time like you and I. So God instituting a law that man could not uphold was not a reaction to man's actions. Rather, it was an action of God. Why would God do that? Why would he give us a law? Why would he give us a set of rules and regulations that we could not keep? Why? Because he needed to show humanity something. That there had to be something greater than rules and regulations and laws and sacrifices. There had to be something greater, something bigger for man to not just be acceptable to God. God wanted man to be something bigger than just acceptable. And Jesus said it like this in Matthew, the 5th chapter. Verse number 17, Jesus says, I did not come to destroy the law. He says, but I did come to fulfill. You see, nobody could live up to the expectations of the law that God had put into humanity. But Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy it. He said, I came that it would be fulfilled. I am the one and the only human being on earth who could physically actually live up to the laws of God. And because I came and I fulfilled the law, and then at the end of that fulfillment, I gave myself as a sacrifice, a spotless lamb according to the law, I have now fulfilled it. He says, I didn't abolish it, I fulfilled it. Because God doesn't want you to be tolerable. Just like you've got relationships of people you tolerate. That is not what God wants for you, is to tolerate you. Somebody needs to say amen to that one. God wants something bigger, and Jesus came to bring something bigger to you and I. Jesus came to bring the message of the cross to humanity today. What is the message of the cross? I am so glad that you have asked that question. Pastor Luke, what are you getting at? Go with me to Colossians in the 2nd chapter. Go. Get there. Hustle. Let's run. Because the Spirit of God is going to drop on this place. Second, Colossians chapter number 2. I love this. Verse number 13. Colossians 2, verse 13. Grunt at me, holler at me, say something when you're there. All right, you're there. The message of the cross. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 13. It says, and you. Look at your neighbor and say, that's me. That's you. All right, now you may not want to be so proud about that yet. It says, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh. That literally means to be dirty, to be disconnected with your flesh. And you, because of all of this nastiness in life, were dead. But he, Jesus, has made us, you and me, alive together with him, Jesus, having forgiven all your trespasses. But look at what it says in verse number 14. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, he says, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. But he doesn't even go. He goes a little bit further. And he says, having disarmed the principalities and powers and made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. You and I have a handwriting of requirement against us. The things that we do in life, things like greed, things like lies. Pastor Luke, I try not to lie. When you were 2 years old and you ate the cookie out the cookie jar and your mama asked you, was that you? And you said, no, it wasn't. You had already started lying. Nobody had to teach you how to lie. Things like drunkenness and hate. How about fighting and enmity? Prejudice. How about pride and prejudice? Okay, anyways. Things like hurt and lack. These are the handwritings of the requirements that were against us. These are the things that we do. But I love what it says in verse number 14. It said it like this. It said, Jesus, having wiped out. The handwriting of requirements that were against us, he comes and he writes in a new thing. He writes the word reconciled. Reconciled. The new writing of requirement of you and I. Reconciled. The message of the cross is reconciliation. The message of the cross is reconciliation. Reconciliation. My wife's an accountant, so you know what she has to do? She has to balance bank statements. I know whenever it's the end of the month and it's time to balance bank statements, because I can just see it on her face, that she has to go through all of the transactions of a bank statement, all of the different things that come in and all the different things that go out, and she has to balance it so that every penny is accounted for. And I have woke up in the middle of the night to see her in bed with her laptop at 2 and 3 in the morning, frustrated because I can't find a penny. And I tell her, I said, babe, it's 1 cent off. That's good enough. But you see, to reconcile literally means to make right, to make compatible. God didn't come to send Jesus on the cross to make us good enough. God came to send Jesus on the cross so that we would be made right, made compatible, made whole in Jesus Christ. No longer the message of the cross is that no longer are we tolerable in the eyes of God. Now we are whole. We are compatible. We are united. We are connected. We are related to Jesus and God. No longer are we separated by a chasm of sin and death. Now we have been reconciled, made whole, made right, made compatible again with God through Jesus Christ. Now that's exciting, but it gets a little bit better. You see, the world from the very beginning has tried to find heaven without God. All the way back to the story of the Tower of Babel. They said, let us build a tower to heaven so that we could get there ourselves. And you know the story, God confused their languages and he spread them abroad. From the very get-go, man has tried to get to heaven without God. But let me tell you something, you can't get to heaven any other way. You see, it's not about a philosophical thought. It's not about a religious idea. It's not about a historical character. It's not about some unique or spiritualized text. Why? Because there is only one person who fulfilled the law of God that brought man to the place of righteousness with him. And that one person is Jesus. So therefore, there is only one way to be reconciled with God. And it is not positive thinking. It is not a religious or a spiritual attitude. Jesus is the only way. Thus he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through me. In Romans, the 5th chapter, verse number 10, Paul the Apostle talks about it, and he says it like this. He says, for when we were enemies, did you know you were at odds with God? No, I didn't even know. In your mind, you didn't even know. In your life, you didn't even know. In your ignorance, you didn't even know. But yet, while we were enemies with God, we were reconciled, brought to a position of righteousness, brought to a place of right standing. The handwriting of requirements were wiped away, and now we are brought to a place of compatibility with God. Not just acceptability, but compatibility through the death of his son. having much more been reconciled, I love this, we shall be saved by his life. Jesus says, I have come that you would have life and have life more abundantly. So I love what Paul says. He says, look at verse number 11. He says, and not only that, but we rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because we have received the reconciliation. Church, it doesn't matter what's going on in life. It doesn't matter the ups and the downs and the ins and the outs. We have joy because we are no longer tolerable to God. We are no longer just acceptable to God. We are now reconciled to God. We are compatible to God. We have been restored to our rightful position of royalty to God. So much fun. My kids, we like to read them to them at night, and my parents did it to me, my mama did it to me, so we decided to do it to them, and we've been reading through the books of Narnia, the Chronicles of Narnia, from very beginning to all the way through all seven books. And I think The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, has anybody ever read the book, seen the movie? If you haven't, let me see. Yes, I need to know how many people know this. If you have not, go watch the movie or read the book. Okay, you got to get it. C.S. Lewis writes the message of the gospel in the Chronicles of Narnia. And here there's a young boy who finds his way into this magical, mystical land called Narnia through a wardrobe. I know you're like, what are you talking about, Pastor Luke? It's fiction, all right? And this young boy named Edmund, the very first person he comes into contact with is this beautiful white queen. She's really the white witch of Narnia, the wicked witch of Narnia. And so Edmund doesn't know any different. So he makes an alliance, or he makes an allegiance. He makes a promise to her to bring his family to her. But her intention is to destroy humanity so that she could have her place as authority over Narnia for all eternity. So as the story goes on, that the two brothers and the two sisters, Peter, Edmund, Lucy, and Susan, as they come into Narnia, they come in. Edmund abandons them and betrays them, and he goes to the White Witch's castle while they go to meet Aslan the Lion. Aslan the Lion is a representation of Jesus Christ. And there, as Edmund realizes his wrongdoing, as he realizes that he has made an alignment, an ally with the wrong person, he realizes that his life is now in jeopardy, and the witch seeks to destroy him, but before she does, she wants to use him as bait to kill his brother and two sisters. And so Edmund comes in, and she's taking Edmund there, and Aslan sends a rescue party, and they take Edmund back, and Edmund walks in the camp of Aslan, the righteous and the royal camp, the true king of Narnia, and as he walks in, everybody looks at the prodigal son who returns, but then the witch comes back, and she comes and she says, I'm going to claim my property, Edmund. And she says, you know the laws of Narnia. You know the rules of Narnia, that his blood must be spilt because he is a traitor. And if he does not die, she says, all of the land of Narnia will be upheaved in fire and brimstone. And so there's a hopeless, the handwriting of requirement was laid against Edmund. There was no solution, but as Aslan makes a covenant with the witch, he sacrifices himself, and he lays himself to die in the stead of Edmund, so that Edmund could not just be acceptable to Narnia, but that Edmund would be reconciled to his rightful place as a king of Narnia. You see, C.S. Lewis wrote the gospel into that message. Edmund is you and I. We didn't know we made an allegiance. We didn't know we were united. We didn't know we were connected with something that looked so beautiful and looked so powerful, but that was the handwritings of requirements against us, our allegiance with this world. But Jesus Christ, like Aslan, came and he laid himself down on the cross. The message of the cross is reconciliation. He laid himself down, not so that we could be acceptable to God, but that we could be reconciled to God, so that we could be like Edmund, restored to a place of royalty. So the Bible says about you that you are a king, you are a priest, you are a royal nation, a peculiar people. That is only because the message of the cross is reconciliation. But it gets better. Because in John, before Jesus goes to the cross, he prays for you. Think about this for a moment. Jesus Christ prays for you. In John, the 17th chapter, Jesus prays, and he says it like this in John the 17th chapter, verse number 20. He says, I don't just pray for these alone, talking about his disciples. He says, but I pray for those who will believe in me through their, my disciples' word. Look what it says, verse number 21. That they all, that's you and me, that's you. Jesus is praying for you right here. He says that they all may be one. unified, together, connected. But look what Jesus says, because that's exciting, that's great. But we can see Super Bowl shows that say believe in love. And that could unify us together, right? We can stand for social justice and end slavery, and that can unify us together. But look what Jesus says. He says that they may be one as you are in me and I in you. Jesus says that they may be one in us. Jesus didn't pray that we, his church, we, his people, would be unified by a social idea. He didn't pray that we would be unified by a good thought. He didn't pray that we would be unified by, activism. He prayed that we would be unified as a father is to his son and a son is to his father. Jesus says, God, bring them into the family bloodline. They are now a part of me. They are in me. They are in you. You are in them. I am in them. We are all one together. We are no longer at odds with God. Now we are reconciled to God, made compatible. You see, your DNA has changed. My kids, today's my little boy's fifth birthday. My kids, Bjorn and Emma, they look like their mom. And a little bit of me. They look like a little bit of me. But you know what? When Stacy and I, when we decided we were going to have kids, we didn't say, God, I pray, Lord, oh, Father in heaven, that you would make my children look just like me. Stacy didn't say, well, I don't know if she did. She might have. Wouldn't have been a bad thing. She didn't say, Lord, I pray that our children would look just like us. I pray that they would have our mentality. I pray that they would have our mindsets. I pray that we would see everything about us in them. We never prayed that. But you know what's funny? They came out, and as they're growing up, it's like, man, I see me in you. And I see mom in you. And I see everybody in you. How does that happen? Why? I didn't ask for that. I didn't choose that. It's DNA. They were born into that. And Jesus prays, Lord, I pray that they would be one as I in you and you in me. I pray that they would be one in us. Now all of a sudden, you don't have to think about, man, I want to try to be like Jesus. I want to try to be a member of the family. Man, I really wish, I really hope, I really would love to be a part of the royal family. Jesus says, you don't have to start thinking about it anymore. Why? Because your DNA on the inside of you has changed, and now you are a part of the family. You are like Jesus. You are a son and a daughter of the Most High God. Your DNA is completely different, no longer identified by the color of your skin, by the ethnic background of where you came from, no longer identified by your college education, no longer identified by the amount of money you make. Now we are identified by Jesus Christ because we have been reconciled, made compatible to God. Paul the Apostle knew this. He preaches it in Galatians, the third chapter, verse number 28. He says it like this. He says, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. Why? Because you are all one in Jesus Christ. You are all one in Jesus Christ. The person next to you is now your blood relative in Jesus Christ. Because you're not acceptable to God, you're reconciled to God. The message of the cross, church, is reconciliation. Can I get an amen? The message of the church is reconciliation. No longer is it viva la raza, because you and I are the race of Jesus Christ. You and I are the kin of the Most High God. You and I, who were once enemies, the Bible says, in our minds, in the futility of our minds, God has stepped in with his unmerited favor and his grace and his love for humanity and manifest it so loud and so much so that the world could see that he says, I don't want you any longer to be tolerable in my eyes. I want you to be my son. I want you to be my daughter. I want you to be a king's kid. I want you to have an inheritance, and not an inheritance of money, not an inheritance of wealth, not an inheritance of homes or business. I want you to have an inheritance of the kingdom of God that is not limited to the foundations of earth, but is all over all of creation from beginning to end, that we will reign and rule with Jesus Christ. Christ, because now we who were once afar off, alienated, are now brought together with Jesus Christ, because the message of the cross is reconciliation. Dang. Dang. So if the message of the cross is reconciliation, that's great. I like to holler, I like to hoot, I want to stand and wave a hanky, but here's the thing to take away. The message of the cross is reconciliation, but the method of delivery is you. The message of the cross is reconciliation, but the method of delivery is you. You see, God sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross for all humanity, but now it's you and I, little Christians, little Jesuses, walking around the earth, telling our story of reconciliation, telling our story of the handwritings of requirements wiped out against us and being replaced by this wonderful, amazing word called reconciliation. You see, now all of a sudden, your life has a purpose, and it's not just to exist, to breathe in and to breathe out and to breathe in and to breathe out for the 80 or something years that you might live if the Lord tarries. Your life's purpose is to share and to proclaim the gospel of reconciliation to the world, who needs to know that they have been reconciled with their choice to follow and accept Jesus into their lives. We know 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, verse number 17. Why? Because we say it like this: behold, all things, old things have passed away, right? All things become new. I am a new creation in Christ. I love that. Verse number 18, 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter. Paul the Apostle says it like this. He says, now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus, and has given us, Paul says, I've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Verse number 19, he goes on and he says it like this. He says, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, and not imputing their trespasses, but like we said, wiping the handwriting of requirements away from us. It says, now he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Paul says, I have been given a commission in my life to teach and to preach and proclaim the reconciliation of God to his beloved humanity, to his beloved creation, to his most prized possession here on earth, his people. He says, now my job, my ministry, my word, my teaching, my preaching, my life is all about the ministry of reconciliation. Jesus tells his disciples in John the 15th chapter, verse number 12, he says, I give you a commandment. I want you to do something. He says, I want you to love as I have loved you. Go and love. And I love this. In verse number 13, he says, and how did I love you? He says that there is no greater love than one to lay down his life for his friends. Amen. Jesus commissioned his disciples with the ministry of reconciliation. He said, hey, it's time. Now you know. You're aware. You're fired up and you're ready to go because you understand your position in Christ. He says, now it's time for you to lay down. Lay down what? Lay down your prejudice. Lay down your pride. Lay down your personal ambition. Lay down your ideas. Lay down your insecurities. Lay down what you hope and dream and think that life should be like. He says, lay that down for the sake of love. And because God so loved the world, we so love the world, he says, I want you to go and I want you to lay down your life, whatever it might be, to share the ministry of reconciliation to the world that needs to know it. Because church, you and I both know, we cannot stay here in this building and hooting and hollering. We got to go. We got to get out of here. We got to go tell somebody about Jesus in our life. Through our actions, through our words, through our lives, through our ministry, we are all, like my daddy used to teach the church a long time ago, we are all full-time ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of reconciliation at your job, at the workplace, at the school, at the family dinner table, around the circle of friends on Facebook or Instagram or whatever it may be. You are a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the message of the gospel, the message of the cross, is reconciliation, and you are God's delivery system to get it to the world. Man, I tell you, I think each and every one of us can think of at least one person in our lives that needs to know about the gospel of reconciliation. And now we leave today and we say, God, would you give us an opportunity to share? Would you give us an opportunity to shine your light, the gospel and the message of the cross, to somebody that needs to hear it. Listen, next week is Easter. It's probably the greatest evangelical tool that God set up for the new Christian church, because everybody wants to come to church on Easter. And maybe this week your assignment could be simply to share the message of reconciliation by inviting somebody to church. Check out this video. The message, the identity, you're no longer tolerable to God through Jesus. God doesn't want to just tolerate you. He wants to bring you into the family. That doesn't just happen because Jesus died and now everybody's okay. It comes by the conscientious decision to choose and to follow and to serve after Jesus Christ with all of your heart and with all of your life. You see, Jesus told a religious man in the book of John, in the outskirts of Jerusalem, in John the 3rd chapter, he says, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. Born again's not what you think. Born again's not what society and Hollywood's made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing in the heart and in the eyes of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's not a mental assent. It's not a carnal knowledge of who God is. It's not a question of, well, you know what, if I was to die today, you know, I think I'd go to heaven. I hope I'd go to heaven. I really want to go to heaven. That's not what it is. So you can't find in the Bible that you can hope or you can think or you can want. You can't find in the Bible that because your parents took you to church as a child and you were baptized as a baby or christened. You can't find it in the Word of God that because you went to catechism classes or Sunday school classes, you can't find in the Word of God because you've got a cross around your neck or because you checked off the word Christian on the census as it came by your door or because you've got a tattoo somewhere on your body that has a reference of Scripture or to God. You cannot find in the Word of God that these are what make you reconciled to God. You see, the only thing that you and I can do to become reconciled with God is to accept God's gift. The Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Jesus, I quoted it earlier today, Jesus said that I have come that you would have life and that you would have life more abundantly. He says the thief doesn't come except to steal, to kill, and destroy. The things that we do, the things that we enact, the things that we do, even despite the fact that we don't want to do them, Jesus says those are the works of the devil in whom we found ourselves as humanity bound to by very birth. But you see, Jesus came and he died for us on a cross so that we could decide, so that we could choose, so that we could see our Savior. And we could accept him into our heart and accept him into our life, to accept him as our personal Lord and Savior, to be reconciled with him together through the cross. Well, how does that come? Jesus says it like this in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. Jesus is speaking to a church. He says, listen, I'm coming back. He says, I'm returning. He says, when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. I will reject you. I will expel you from the kingdom of God. What does that mean, lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means, you know, you've got your ups and your downs. You've got your ins and your outs. Occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. Jesus says, listen, if that's you, you're not making it. Just because you come to church on a regular basis, on a semi-regular basis, or you visit every once in a while, just because you have a Bible on your bookshelf or because you've got a cross around your neck doesn't mean that you're going to get to heaven. And I love you enough and I'll respect you enough to tell you the truth. See, the American church has watered the message down for centuries. So now all we think is we got to come and sit in a church service and be a good person. And that's all we got to do to be right with God. But let me tell you something. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you sit in church service, it means that you're going to get into heaven. Jesus says in that same statement, he says, listen, he says, I come and I stand at the door and I knock. And he says, he who opens the door, he says, I will come in and I will dine with him and he with me and we will be together, just like we read today in Jesus' prayer. Jesus says, I am knocking at the door of your heart. And it's not about a religious affiliation. It's not about a ceremony or a traditional ritual. It's not about a mental ascent or mental knowledge of who God is. Pastor Luke, I know all about Jesus. Listen, I know all about the president, but that doesn't mean I know him personally. You can know all about Jesus and miss him personally. You see, Jesus right now, the Bible says that no one comes to the Father unless the Spirit of God draws him. Jesus, I believe right now, is knocking on the door of your heart, saying you've been living yourself to yourself. You've been living these things. You've been hating the life that you've been living in, and you've been finding that is nothing but death for long enough. And he says, I am knocking now. Will you accept life? Will you accept life in Jesus Christ? Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept the life of Jesus Christ in your life, to ensure your place with God in heaven forever and ever and ever, and to have life here on earth with Jesus Christ, to be reconciled with him. And see, I don't want to give you the opportunity to just say, well, you know, let's do this. You know, you can say, well, Pastor Luke, I'll find God my way. You find God your way. Let's do it some well-meaning author's way. Listen, the only way we can do it is God's way. And Jesus said it like this. Jesus said that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you before his Father. The decision is yours and total yours. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to come and force his way in or make his way in. You see, he did everything he could to ensure your salvation, your eternal destiny with him, your connection, your reconciliation and reconnection with him, compatibility with him, by sending Jesus to die on a cross for you and for me, for our sin and our shame. And now in return, he wants you to accept and to live a life after Jesus Christ. All of your heart, all of your life, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has meant the same thing in the eyes and the heart of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life, not just some mental assent, not some thought, not some token prayer, but everything. Because you see, God gave everything for you, his only begotten Son, so that you and I would have everlasting life. Today I want to give you the opportunity to receive that gift, to accept that gift. Like any gift, you have a choice. You can accept the gift or you can reject it. You can return it. And today I want to give you that opportunity. And as Jesus said, you confess me before men. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go like this. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three, and I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that, bang. And when I smack my hands together, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to make a decision today. I'm going to ask you to make a decision to follow Jesus Christ. And how you make that decision, you say, you know what, I'm going to follow Jesus, and you raise your hand. You see, I'm a man, I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, and you can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. Who should raise their hands in this place today? If you've never given your heart, if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you feel that emptiness and that brokenness on the inside of you, that hurt, and you found yourself here today, listen, this is your divine appointment with God to accept and to receive life today through Jesus Christ. Who should raise their hands? If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in a crusade or something like that before, but you never really followed through and you just don't know. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit on the inside of us is God's stamp of approval that we should know. You do not need to walk out of this place questioning or wondering, am I right with God? Today, you could know for sure by making that decision today, and we'll follow through in just a moment together. Who should raise their hands in this place in just a moment? If that's you, if you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, listen, if you've been running from God instead of to God, been playing the church thing on Sunday morning, but Monday through Friday, Monday through Saturday, you're kind of doing your own thing, and then back at church on Sunday doing God's thing, listen, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough today to tell you the truth, not going to make it. God's not after games. He's not after, token prayers. God's after all of your heart. He's after all of your life through Jesus Christ. And today, I want to give you the opportunity to accept life through Jesus by making that decision. In just a moment, we're going to pray. And as we pray, what you're doing by the raising your hand and you're saying, Pastor Luke, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, I want to be included in that prayer. Pastor Luke, I want to have a new life today. You see, I'm a man, I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down. And right after that, we'll follow through with that together and pray together. If that's you in this place, all across this auditorium, from side to side, from front to back, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, in just a moment, when I count to three, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down from there. This is your moment. This is your time. Listen, today is the day of your salvation, March 20th of 2016. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now it's a divine appointment between you and God, right here, right now. The Spirit of God speaking to you, saying, come home. I'm knocking on your door. Now, church, it's time for you in this place to answer, to respond. The message of the cross of Jesus Christ is reconciliation. God wants you to be compatible with him once again and to give you life and inheritance as one of his children. And it starts by making the decision to accept in Jesus into your heart, into your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. So I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you in this place, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. Wherever you're at, if you're outside watching on campus, on the televisions, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Wherever you're at, today is the day of your salvation. I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it, I'll acknowledge you, and put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I see you right over there. Eight, nine, I see you. Ten, I see you right there. 10 wise people. Anybody in the family rooms back there? I don't see anybody. 10 wise people. Anybody else? I got you right there in the back row. 11. Anybody else in this place in the family rooms over there? 12. All right. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. This is your moment. This is your time. The Spirit of God's calling you, drawing you home, saying, come on, open the door to salvation today. Anybody else? 12 wise people. Anybody else in the house today? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 12 or so wise people. Amen. Here's what we're going to do. You're making that decision to follow Jesus. I said, we're going to pray a prayer, and you raising your hand says, I want to be included in that prayer. So what we're going to do is we're all going to gather together. If you raise your hand, listen, now it's time. You're making a decision. You know this. This is logic, and this is reasoning, understanding 101, that any decision without action is no decision at all. You can decide to do anything but never do anything about it, and nothing will ever happen. Today, you're deciding to act upon the decision that you're making to follow Jesus Christ. And so if that's you in this place, all 12 of you that raised your hands, you should have raised your hand, but maybe you didn't. Listen, it's not too late for you. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody, look at them and say, hey, come on, will you go with me? Or if somebody next to you raised their hands, look at them and say, come on, you know what, I'll go with you. Let's go together. And I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me here at this altar, because we're going to pray together. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. Elijah's going to sing a song. And as we do, I want everybody to stand. Please, nobody leave. And if that's you, if you raise your hands, come on, get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here. Let's change destinies together right here, right now.
We'll come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide.
You come on, if that's you, come on.
Forgiveness was broken. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. It's okay. If you raised your hands, come on. Get out of your seat. Choose life in Jesus today.
Jesus Christ.
Praise God, as they're coming. Listen, there's not 12 up here, but I saw 12 hands. And listen, I got to tell you the truth. I've been in front. I've been preaching at you all day. And that's okay. You guys still come. It's all right. But if you raise your hand, somebody's got to love you enough to tell you the truth that you can't get saved because you raise your hand in a church service and everything's right between you and God. If you can't make a decision to follow Jesus in church, what makes you think outside of the walls of this auditorium you're going to follow after that decision? It starts today by acting on that decision. And I'm going to ask Elijah to sing that verse one more time. And if that's you in this place and you raised your hand and you're serious about this today, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come on, let's change destinies together right here, right now. Come on, you come.
So come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Praise God. If they're coming, you can still come. You come.
Jesus Christ.
Well, hey guys, you came. And somebody's got to tell you. Maybe you've never heard it before in your life, but somebody needs to tell you this right now. Good job. Good job. You are making the very best decision you can possibly make today. Great job. Here's what we're going to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple of things with you. He's going to do something. I said we're going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to pray to accept and to invite Jesus into your heart, into your life. He's going to lead you in a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. We don't want you to leave this place empty-handed. We want to hook you up with information because you walk out of here and say, what do I do next? We want to point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back, to hang out with us. We want to get you connected with somebody here at the church. We call them spiritual personal trainers. They'll sit with you at our cafe. They'll buy a cup of coffee or soda, some french fries, teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks. Not some big, long program or massive commitment. We're asking you to meet with a friend for a couple of weeks so that they can teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you to be compatible with Jesus Christ. Your whole life is ahead of you today. Today is your new birthday. Congratulations. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Amen. Let's give the Lord a great big praise today.